Hey, hey, everybody, welcome on into ClayShare Live. I'm Jessica Putnam-Phillips. Each week we bring you a live tutorial, and this week we are going to be using the awesome new underglaze decal collab I did with Sanbao Studios, and that's my new orchard and buoys, and we're going to make these super cute little plates right here. So I got this one, and we got this little guy, and what we're going to do is after we make them, when they set up to leather hard, as these are, we're gonna add color. And I'm gonna use the Colors for Earth underglazes, which are the ones that I have here, and they're translucent, and we'll talk about them as we go through this. So this is a great tutorial for those of you who wanna use underglaze decals and don't know how to, or wanna add color to your underglaze decals. So this will be a good one for everybody. I'm super excited. And I'm gonna make two different size plates, two different ways. Well, one's a little trinket dish, and one's a plate. But you'll get it. You'll see. It's going to be fun. I promise. All right. So, hey, hey, everybody. I see a lot of folks here. Let me grab the underglaze decals. So many of you know, or perhaps you do not know, that I also work as an illustrator, and I do a lot of design work, which I used to have an agent. Well, I still technically have an agent, but I don't license my work out through my agency anymore. Although some of my work is still out there and you still find it at Michael's and a lot of craft stores and on wallpapers and things like that. But I keep my artwork now because I collaborate with other companies and we do designs for the ceramic world, whether it's rolling pins or underglaze decals or cutters with De La Design and all kinds of stuff. So my most recent two designs are this perfect for fall orchard right here. And I love that it's a giant sheet, so you can make a huge platter with it if you want to. And then the other one, which some of you are going into spring or in spring right now, so summer's just around the corner, this is perfect for you. This is my buoys. So this is a whole bunch of different buoys, nautical buoys, very summery. And on the buoys, some of them have stripes, some of them have a crab, a little lobster, a little seahorse, a steering wheel of a ship, an anchor, octopus, all kinds of a life preserver, all kinds of cute little things on here. So you might want to check this out if you're getting close to summer. But here in Vermont, it is fall, full on fall. And we have about three more days of fall, and then it's going to be winter. So I got to get my fall stuff done because I'm going to be wading through snow in about a week, probably. Yes, we have winter that lasts forever, but it's just how it is. All right, so it doesn't matter what underglaze decal you have. The things I'm going to show you tonight are ways to use underglaze decals. So if you don't have my designs from Sanbao or other designs from Sanbao, I do encourage you to check it out. We have a discount with them. It's ClayShare 15, so that's C-L-A-Y-S-H-A-R-E, 1-5, lowercase, the whole way. And you'll save 15% off Sanbao underglaze decals. So you can get some and try them out. I will be premiering the new Christmas underglaze decals that aren't available yet from Sanbao in prime time next. So that's the private broadcast I do for my premium members of ClayShare. And I'm also giving away this big fat stack of underglaze decals. There are nine, that's right, nine sheets of underglaze decals in here that I'm giving away to one of my lucky premium members. And you don't have to do anything but be a member and you win. And this is from my own stash. So there's a bunch of ones in here that you might not be able to get anymore because Sanbao doesn't make them anymore. Maybe they ran out of stock and they're out of stock and they're in super high demand. Yeah, so that's gonna happen. All right, would any underglaze work? Absolutely, yes, and I did just cover that, but I like to answer the questions you all have. All right, we're gonna make little slab plates, and you've seen me make slab plates many, many times. It's one of my favorite ways to make plates. I like how we can consistently make a plate the same size every time, so you get the exact same result. Now, I really like throwing too, and I like how when we're making things on the wheel, there can be slight variations. But for me, making plates from slabs is the way to go. And I have got something awesome to share. My premium members know about this, but On ClayShare, we have a sister site, and that's ClayShare Market, and that's where we sell the rolling pins. That's the Orchard design, actually. Do I have it back here? I got a bunch of designs you can't see that are super. Is Orchard over there? So the Orchard design actually was a rolling pin, and you can order it, but we are about 8 to 12 weeks out for shipping on rolling pins. And same with buoys, that's a rolling pin. But the underglaze decals you can order and get much faster. So this right here was the Orchard rolling pin, and that's what inspired the underglaze decal. The other things we have on ClayShare Market is these fabulous digital downloads. So we have template shapes, all different sizes, that will work with GR pottery forms, but they also will work with forms you make yourself if you want to make molds. And I have a bunch of classes teaching you how to make molds on ClayShare. So if you're somewhere that you can't get the GR pottery forms, or you just like making your molds yourself, which who doesn't, you can use your own homemade molds and use the templates, or you can get the GR pottery forms. And when you use our templates, we tell you what size that it's made for, but it doesn't mean that's the only size. Like, this is made for the 5-inch GR pottery form, but I've used it for the 6 with the 6.5, and I've used it with the cutie. So there's things you can do to change that. That's just a recommendation, and you know, recommendations, they're just guidelines. All right, so you get this as a download and you print it out, and you can print it out on paper. And I use paper templates for many, many years successfully. There's never a problem. You can cut it out and then laminate it. You can cut out the template, lay it on a sheet of craft foam, trace around the edge, and then cut out the craft foam, and then you have a template that's going to last a long time. Now, because I make rolling pins, I have laser machines that engrave them. So I have the capability of making wooden ones. So you could take your digital downloadable file, and if you don't have a laser machine, most libraries are starting to get these, and community centers are starting to get laser machines or glow forges, or maybe you know somebody, you could have a wooden one made. Or what I think is fabulous is we've made the files so that you can use it with a Cricut or a Silhouette or any other die cutter. Here's one that we just did this afternoon on my Cricut. You put your craft foam on your mat, you cut it out, and then I'm just gonna go to the overhead and I'll peel it. We're gonna do a peel. It's a live peel. just for you guys to see. Ready? Oh, I love the Cricut. A Silhouette would work, any other die cutter. It's great. So now I have this fabulous template, and when you get the files, when you print out the paper one, it's gonna say on it, shape, wide pumpkin, size small, because there's three sizes in the wide pumpkins. And this works with the 5-inch circle GR pottery form. Although I've used it with the oval, you can use it with the hex forms, you can use it with other shapes. You're not limited. It's just when we make them, we like to give at least one on there. So you get that information there. If you use the file to cut it out with a laser engraver, it will engrave that information on it. When you do it on craft foam, it doesn't engrave the stuff for you. So you just need to go ahead and get yourself a Sharpie, which you should have anyway, in your studio. Or you could just use a ballpoint pen, but a Sharpie is gonna work better. And then you can say small, wide, pumpkin. And this is for all the folks that were asking recently, because I've gotten a ton of messages in the last couple weeks since we released the pumpkin templates. How they can use them if they don't have a laser machine and can't cut them out. Well, you don't need one. So this works with the 5-inch GR form. So I just wrote that on there just as a reference, but that's just because, oh, I want to make plates. I want to make small plates. I know that this is the size that'll work perfectly with it. Although the plate you see here, I used the 6.5. So you get a bigger plate, which is what we're going to do tonight. All right, so I hope that was really informative for you guys with the digital download templates. We have a bunch on there, all different shapes and sizes, and we've got two new ones coming in time for the holidays. Actually, we have three, but I'm not supposed to talk about the third one. I see my producer over there cringing. He's like, no, don't say anything about it. And I'm like, come on, darn it. No, I can't talk about it right now. So have I tried writing it with the machine, with the Cricut or Silhouette? I haven't tried writing it, like, they can do it, but I haven't tried it. No, it's, we just do a straight cut, but it's very appealing. I know. See, I should have used that joke. All right, so I got a slab of clay over here. Let me grab it, and we can make some plates with it. So I rolled out a slab of clay, 12 pounds of clay. I rolled out on my slab roller to about 3/8 of an inch thick. And this is what I get. So you can see right here, when you roll out a half a bag, because in America, clay comes in 50-pound bags, and when you cut that bag in a half, it comes in 50-pound boxes. Each bag's 25 pounds of clay. When you cut 25 pounds of clay in half and roll it through your slab roller, you're going to get 12 and a half pounds of clay. Yes, we are doing math tonight, folks. And this is what you get. I get a smaller sheet and then two bigger sheets of clay. Now, I cut these up. I lay it on a sheet of plastic, then wrap it up in plastic. And as long as I keep it wrapped up nice and tight, this can last a week at least. And it doesn't hurt for them to be sitting on each other. They don't stick at this point. It's fine. And so oftentimes I'll roll out a bunch of clay and I'll wrap it up and I'll just have it ready for when I need to use it. That way I don't have to worry about rolling out a slab. It's already done for me. I can just come and grab clay and work. So this is Laguna B-Mix 5. And it's a little thick because I roll it out at 3/8 of an inch so I can take it and thin it down a little if I need to and add texture. And when you add texture and use a rolling pin, you thin it anyways. So let me grab another board to work on and we'll just grab the sheet we need and work with that. So we're gonna make a couple plates tonight. In prime time, we're gonna make mugs two ways. We are gonna make a hand-built mug and a wheel-thrown mug. We're gonna do both tonight. So that's super exciting. Got a little bit of something for everybody in this week's broadcasts. Kevin equals producer, IT, admin, construction worker, husband, cameraman. He does it all. Yes. He has multi-talents. He's multi-talented, I should say. All right, so here's that slab I was saying I was going to use. And it has a texture on it from the canvas because we used canvas on our slab roller. So what are little bottles next to me? Oh, these are the colors for Earth translucent underglazes. So they're like a gel. They're awesome. We're going to talk about these in a second, but not yet. Not yet. We're going to make plates first. All right, I'm going to do, and I put up a quick little video on the ClayShare Instagram and TikTok account. I haven't put it up on Facebook because there's only so many hours in the day. I ran out of time, but I will put it up, but it's basically what I'm doing right now. So you're watching it. You're getting to see it. Need to come in a little closer so we can get everybody in so you can all see everything. So I'm just smoothing this out, and yeah, smoothing it out, it will thin it down a little bit. Probably not as thin as we want to go, but it would be perfect if I decided I was going to roll texture in tonight or stamp texture or use a placemat and roll that in like we did last week in prime time. You know, this would be good because as we're pressing that texture in, we need enough clay to support it so it doesn't crack or break. So if your slabs are too thin and you go to roll a rolling pin in, you're not going to get a good impression. And you know, we're all about making a good impression here at ClayShare. I can never help myself. As hokey as it is, I have to say. do I have the cone 10 recipe for my chun? Yes, but that was part of my honors project as an undergrad student, and I'm not really sharing all that information at this point, but if you look up, well, you won't be able to find it because I did research for a couple years to find it. But we'll figure something out. We'll talk about that. All right, so I have it. I still think it's an okay thickness, but we want to get it down to at least 1/4 inch thick. Maybe a little thinner. Let's see. Let's go a tiny bit thinner. So I've got a rolling pin here, just a plain one. So you know the rolling pins we use that we engrave? This is one of them. Right here, before it's had the engraving done. And they have been rated by Gourmet Magazine as the number one rolling pin for baking. Like, they're the number one rolling pin. So that's a pretty exciting thing that you're getting the best quality rolling pin on the market when you buy a ClayShare rolling pin. You know, just have to put it out there. People always ask what's so special about them, and there's so much. I mean, I don't want to make this about the rolling pins, but if you go and check out the website, we've got all the info there. All right, that's all I'm going to say. Okay, smooth out your slab, and then I'm just going to release it. And so it's a good thickness. It's good for working with. And let's do the small trinket dish first. So to do a little trinket dish, this is a pumpkin cookie cutter I picked up at, I don't know where, somewhere inexpensive. I got a set of them, maybe a Walmart, I don't know, a hobby store. They were all nested in each other, and I got a whole bunch of sizes. But this particular one, so you all can know, is a 4 3/4 inch. And I'm just going to go ahead and see the overhead's a little off center. Let me come over here a little bit. There. All right. So this, we're just going to cut it out. Cut it out. Yeah, we're just cutting it out. That's it. So we've cut out this little pumpkin, but it also could be an apple shape, which is what I love about this. So if you don't want to do pumpkins, because not everybody loves pumpkins like I love pumpkins, you could do a cute little apple. Say it's an apple. Be like, no, no, no. That's an apple. That's not a pumpkin. It's an apple. All right, so we're going to set this slab to the side. And when I use the decals, one of the things that can be an issue for everybody is this edge here. We want to clean it up, but it's going to be where our decal is placed. So if we wait till after we place the decal and then we come back with a damp finger and we do this, you're going to end up smearing your decal and you won't be too pleased, right? So I like to go ahead and fix that edge now and just clean it up. And then let's grab the decals. I have a sheet I've been cutting. It's not that one. Let's find it. A sheet I've been working out of. And you could go ahead and just take the sheet and lay it on if you want to. You could have laid this on all the clay first and transferred it, but you're going to get a lot of waste, a lot of waste of your decal, and you don't want to do that. So what I like to do is I'll take my cutter and I will line it up. Well, that'll be cute right there. And then I take a pencil. You can use a pen. As long as you're not using an underglaze pencil or anything that could transfer, you're fine. And I draw around that, whatever I'm using, template, cookie cutter, doesn't matter. And then I just follow that line and cut it out. So that way there's no waste. And then the little ones you could use for the signature on the back or just a little decorative element somewhere else. Those little scrap bits that we're going to end up generating. All right, so now this is on here. I'm going to line it up. Just press it down, just rub it on a little. Your daughter's allergic to pumpkins, so it's great to make them look like anything else. Make them like apples. I love apples. I love pumpkins, I love apples. I mean, if it's food, I like almost everything. There's very few things I won't eat. All right, so I'm using this yellow rib. You could use a metal rib. If you have the red ones, they work just as well. There's some gray ones out there on the market, but these are really nice, and they do a great job smoothing. But you'll notice that it's not as rich and dark as we might want. So to help it along, we can either wait for a while, and it will transfer, or we can take a damp sponge and kind of pounce it just a bit where the underglaze is. And so this will help the transfer to happen. Now, can give it a little check. So we just peel it up a tiny bit and see, did it come through? And it did. Oh, I'm sorry. I thought you were on the overhead. I got all excited. And I was moving it. Kevin's like, stay there. Like, no, no, I'm going somewhere else. Leave me in charge. All right, so you really can't do anything with this. Use it, it's a one-time use, so you can dispose of the, I just chucked it into the trash. Now, you can see the sheen on the surface. That's because we used moisture and it did soak through the paper a little bit, so it's a little damp. If we went ahead and made our plate right away, you see the black that transferred to my finger? That's gonna transfer onto anything we touch. Now, there's lots of ways to dry this up a bit. I like to blot it, basically. And I like to use cornstarch. Now, you could use cornstarch and use a shaker and shake it on and then brush it. Some people like to use a pouncer. I don't use a pouncer because, think about it, if I touch this right now, I'm gonna transfer that underglaze onto whatever I'm using. And now I've got the, I'm making a mess. So I have found you take a little bit of cornstarch and you just shake it off the brush like that. And then you just smooth it out. You could wait a few minutes and it will dry on its own. And then you don't have to do the cornstarch step. This is just for those of us who are impatient and want to get making, right? And that's all you have to do. Now, to make the little dish part, this is an old memory foam pillow right here that I don't know where it came from. I've had it more than a decade because I've been using it in the studio for about 15 years. All right, so that's all my... Now, for the inside, I made a cut. Look, this is exactly what I wanted to show. I did one earlier that I did not use. I didn't use the cornstarch, and I put my presser on. And this is just a bisque stamp I made using a cutter, just a circle cutter. And I make a whole bunch of these, all different sizes. It's really easy to do. And put a little handle on it so I can hang on to it. And you can make your own pressers. So you can make, they're basically like kind of like a drape mold in a way. You could also, if you don't want to use or make a presser, if you get the little circle cuties from GR Pottery Forms, or in the craft store, you can find sometimes the little tiny wooden plaques. You can use those. But this is what I'm talking about, this transfer. This really shouldn't hurt anything. We're gonna find out live. So I just line this up, and then I press it down and give it a little rock to get those sides up. And you see how it pops up, and we get those really nice raised edges? And then you just lift the whole thing up, put it on another board. See, the transfer is still there, but that's the original. That's not what we just did. So, and then you just adjust your shape, and there you have it. Cute, right? Easy, fast. If you need to make if you want to make trinket dishes or little tea rests or little spoon rests, this is an amazingly fast way to do a whole bunch of them. And it's really quick and symmetrical, like each one of them can be the exact same. Consistent is what I was going for, not really symmetrical, although they can be symmetrical. All right, moving on to the bigger one. I'm gonna use the small, wide pumpkin template. And I'm just gonna go ahead and, while I've got my decal here, I'm just gonna go ahead and trace it out and cut it out. So you want to make sure you don't get these wet until you're ready to use them. If you get them wet, what will happen is the transfer will smudge and smear. And another thing about these is until they have been fired to mid-fire temperatures, they will still smear. So even after bisque firing, these will smear. But once you put a glaze on it, they stop smearing. So all of you who use low-fire clay, they'll be fine once you glaze fire them. They're not gonna smear with glaze on top of them. But you gotta glaze them for low fire. For higher fire, like cone 5 and above, and these can go to cone 10, by the way, but for cone 5 and above, you do not have to glaze them. If you're putting them on the outside of a mug or something and you want that more rustic look, that rough look, you could just go ahead and not glaze them. Especially if you're using a speckly clay, that would be really, I think it'd be really nice with that. All right, so let's go ahead and I'm just grabbing a chunk of clay from that slab. And so we have right here, that craft foam template. But again, if you want to cut it out from paper, you can do that. If you have access to a CNC or laser machine, you can make them out of some MDF. You could make a pumpkin shaped presser. You can make any shaped presser. I make them in ovals, I make them in squares. You can make any shape presser you want. I don't have a class on making a presser, but it's part of the press dishes class. I think there's a trinket dish class, and we go over these in there. Maybe we make them in there. I do know my stamp class, we basically make these because they make great stamps. All right, so you have this shape here. This is the shape we're going to cut out. I'm just going to use a clay knife and just following the template, which, don't worry, you're not being graded. So if you go out of the line, no one's going to know. I'm not telling. There. And so the excess clay gets wedged back up and goes back in the bag. And then voila! It's magic. Plate magic. And then I'm just going to smooth this edge. So if you have old ones that aren't transferring properly, so they the underglaze isn't coming off and transferring onto the clay, could you mist them with water? I mean, you could give it a try. Absolutely. Don't give up. Don't waste them, right? See if you can get them to work. Pouncing them with a damp sponge usually works, but if you want to try misting them with a little bit of water to rehydrate the underglaze, that could help. All right, so now we just did the same thing as we did for the small one. We're going to do this bigger one and line that up. So you've been thinking of using them on a textured plate. So the problem with texture and underglaze decals is the underglaze decal is only going to adhere to the raised part of the texture. You could do a piece that's half and half and leave an area untextured and then cut out your underglaze transfer and put it on there in that untextured area, but they have to go on where they touch the clay, and if you have texture there, they're not going to be touching the clay. So that's really the issue with that. All right, so I've smoothed it on.
Could you do the transfer and then texture it?
You could do stamping as long as you're careful to not press onto the texture. The problem that what I'm concerned with is that the texture could peel up the underglaze. Yeah. But maybe not if you let it set long enough. So definitely something to try out on a small piece if you want to give that a go. Anything's possible. I mean, this is pottery. We can do anything. Anything you can think of can be done. So, you know, give it a try. So I'm just pouncing with a damp sponge. This one's been, I got a new one because look, before, after. How it started, how it's going. That'd be how it started, how it's going, right? This is almost to the end of its life, but I keep them because I can still use it for stuff, so. But little chunks of the sponge starts to come off and gets caught in things. And, you know, that's when you know it's time to say goodbye and move on to a new sponge. All right, now we're going to do another peel. I'll do it on this side. If you have a hard time getting the edge up, so maybe you put it on something and it's really stuck on, you can use a little clay knife to grab the edge like that or a needle tool. Just grab it and go. Oh, I'm using a knife on the wear board. Does it etch the boards? I haven't noticed any etching, but you know what? When we flip this up, I will take a look, see, and we'll see.
You also don't push down very
hard. I don't push very hard. No, I'm not really trying to, you know, gouge into it too much. I'm just trying to get a little, just a little bit of a cut on there. All right, so we're going to sprinkle our cornstarch on the underglaze decals. They were very wet this time. This isn't the same brush I used earlier. That's what I'm looking around for. I'm like, what did I do with it? Thank goodness I got two. There's something in my studio that steals all my tools as I'm using them. It's getting worse as I, the longer I work in pottery. I don't know. It could be anywhere. All right, so I'm just going to dust off the excess of the cornstarch. Cornstarch doesn't really cause any problems. You can even join clay through cornstarch, and I've put on underglazes through cornstarch and haven't had a problem. All right, so we've got our cutie pie ready to go, and I'm going to use that GR pottery form. Now, you could use the 6-inch to make the plate we're going to make tonight. You could use the 5-inch, and you'll get a really wide rim. You could put the cutie on, right, and drape it and make a bowl. You could even do a bowl with these two. So you get two different size bowls with just one template shape. It's pretty awesome. All right, let's line this up. And I just like to turn it around and look at it from above and get it approximately centered. It doesn't have to be perfect. And then we flip it over, just like that. Now the clay I did roll out about an hour before the broadcast, so it's been sitting but wrapped in plastic. It's not super floppy. This is that new B-Mix, and I've noticed it's not as wet as it used to be. All right, and then I'm just going to take and fold the clay down the sides. If you do this and you get cracking here, that's because your clay is too dry. So it's a little note. When I first started making pots this way ages ago, I couldn't figure out why I was getting all this cracking. And it was because clay was too dry. I was letting it set out too long. So I'm just going to use a sponge to smooth the sides down the form. Now we're not going to put a foot on this, which is, I know, surprising so many out there. So it's done. Let me just get the edge again. So I'm not crushing. I'm not wrapping my rib around, and I'm not putting pressure on this point where the bottom meets the side. If you do that, you can thin it, and then they can crack. So if you're getting perfect cracking right here and the bottoms of your plates are popping off, it's probably because you're pushing too much right here and you're thinning it. I'm going to pull this back just a little towards the plate. All right. So one of the great things about working this way is we do not have to wait. I can flip it out immediately and we can continue on with it. It doesn't have a foot, so we don't have to worry about any sagging. It doesn't have a big side, so this is the thing that really makes it so we can remove the form right away. Do you see how the side doesn't drape and actually touch the board? That's what lets us take it out of the form early instead of waiting. So I'm just going to pull up my little stem and down here the little bottom. Just pull that up a little bit. And I got one more little trick up my sleeve for you guys tonight for this part, and then we'll move on to doing the color. So I've got some scrap clay from making, and I was in Joann Fabrics, and I picked up some really great stamp cutters they have in there. And I got this one pack, and it had an oak leaf in it. But it's just a wiggly leaf in my book. You got tool gremlins, steel brushes at your house too. Yeah, I know. It's crazy. So I just press it in, press down, and then we pop it out. And they release really easy. If you're having a hard time with the clay releasing, you could brush it with cornstarch first. But look at this great little leaf I got. Now, of course, if you have Michael Harbridge's leaves from Learn Fired Arts, I love his leaves. They are amazing. But you know, I like to give lots and lots of options for people when we're making, because not everybody has the same resources or the same things available in their area. So you might be able to find these kind of stampers, these stamp cutters, somewhere else. And I know Debbie Dela Cruz from De La Designs has a bunch of really great cutters too. So you can, you know, lots of places you can shop. So I'm going to put this on. If you look at the one I made earlier, here it is. I put it on at a kind of jaunty angle, you know, like a hat on your head. It's got a little jauntiness. Maybe we want to go down with this one and follow the side. I don't know. So these are the things that you have to decide when you're making your little plates, right? These are the decisions, the big decisions in life. What angle to put your leaf on. These are the things that keep me awake at night, I know. I'm kidding. No, they're not. I wish they were. All right, so we're just going to take and slip and score the back. And I can tell where it's touching. Got a little bit, need to put a little bit here. And then when you lay it on, and you pick it back up, you'll see some of this slip is left behind, so I know that's where I have to slip and score. This has been the best serrated rib. I have to tell you, it's a Cheryl Mud Tool L12. I use it so much. When I bought it, I was at Enseca, and I was on, you know, how we get a little tool crazy when we're at conferences, and I bought it. I didn't know how much I was going to use it. All right, so I'm supporting from the back and just gently pressing down with my thumb. And I'm kind of pushing downward on the leaf. So it's sort of sticking on the rim a little. So see if I can show you. And you see how I pressed it down a little bit? Just kind of like that. It also gives it more character and flow. It's not just this flat, static thing. It doesn't look like it's just sticking off the side funnily. It's formed to it, so it looks like it's part of it. And you can, you know, tweak these little leaves here. And then if you have any slip coming out there from where your join is, and you want to take care of that, a really easy way to do that is if you have a color shaper. So that's these little silicone rubber tip things. And you can get them in, oh my gosh, so many. I've got many different shapes and sizes. I'm always buying these everywhere I see them. I always buy a pack. Yeah, and I could spend the whole broadcast. But I'm not finding the one I want. There it is. My favorites are this one that's tapered all the way around. I love that one. And then the flat one and the chisel one. Those are really great. So we just go in here and you just wipe off any slip, and you do it carefully. You don't smear your decal at all. And then this seam that we have in here, you just come in and gently smooth that. I'll do that again. Just take the seam, and you just gently smooth it out. There. And then you let it dry. And I have found flat plates like this will tend to bow. They try to bow up. So to counteract that, as soon as it's leather hard, almost leather hard, you know, stiffened up enough so that the sides aren't going to collapse on me, I will take a weight bag. This is just scoopable kitty litter in an old t-shirt, and I lay it on there, and that keeps it flat. And I keep that on the whole time, and until I'm ready to add the color, and then even after I add color to it, I put the weight bags back on. There's a bunch of fondant stamps I shared a while ago with a bunch of leaves, more finicky than this one. Yes, I love the fondant cutters. They are amazing. There's a lot of flower ones that I've not found anywhere else. All right, so this is the one we have, and I want to add color. So we have a couple choices. You know, when this fires, this clay is white, and these trees are going to be black. So we're going to have a very black and white piece to start with. Now we could just do a single glaze on it and like a celadon or something, and that would be fine. I just want to see if this will clean up my edge there. But I want to add a translucent color to the trees. I want to tint them a little. And it's autumn here, so I want to go with some autumn colors. And Colors for Earth makes these really great translucent underglazes. Most underglazes are not translucent. You can use any underglaze you want. Just keep in mind that if it's not translucent, it's going to hide your underglaze decal. Now, maybe in some areas you want that, but just keep that in mind when you're working. So I made a little test plate of the Colors for Earth, so I know what they look like. So I have a guideline, and I'm going to go ahead and use the red geranium, the Florida orange, this curry, which is really nice. And I'm also going to mix it with the green leaf and the laurel leaf. Now the laurel leaf goes almost opaque when it's really thick, so you're going to go light with that if you're going to use it. But this is going to be my palette. It's very, very autumnal. If it's spring where you are, maybe you want brighter greens and other colors. So it's entirely up to where you are and what colors you want. So I'm going to grab those. This is red geranium. And then I need Florida orange. The curry is down low here. I think it's where I put it. Sienna, burnt sienna. I have a few. See them all? There's a lot. Can't help myself. Tangerine peel. Oh, I didn't do a test of that one yet. Coral. I haven't tested that one yet either. And there's CC125. I wonder if that's the curry. Because I don't write the numbers on. I'll have to look at the little guides. All right, so do your test plates so you know what your colors are going to look like. You can use Mako stroke and coats. So here they are. When they're thin, they're still translucent. And then you can put a clear glaze on top. So stroke and coats would be a nice option for anybody out there that doesn't have the colors for Earth. I mean, I'll show you what I got here. The Amoco's velvet tend to go really opaque quickly. They can be used if you water them down a lot. Just keep it in mind that they do go very opaque, which is nice, but maybe not what you want all the time, right? So the Mako stroke and coats can be translucent when they're thinned and as well as the colors for Earth. And the colors for Earth do work at 06. Absolutely, they work better at 06. They stay brighter and truer. These are fired to cone 5. And you can see this is deep cranberry. You see how it burned away to a gray? So anybody going to cone 5, your deep cranberry is a beautiful gray. So if you want a gray, that's I mean, she makes a gray. So you probably don't want to buy cranberry to use it as a gray. All right, so I got a bunch of these colors. And then to use them, I have a palette, a covered palette. But we're just going to quickly use a couple colors. So I'm going to use one of these inexpensive little dollar palettes that you get at the craft store. Maybe they're now $2. I don't know. And we're just going to put a drop. You want to mix them up. I'm pretty sure this is the curry. Somebody know CC125. Tell me, is that curry? Kevin's going to look it up. I need a yellow, though. I got tangerine. CC125.
Curry.
I guessed it. Look at me. All right. So I've got tangerine, Florida orange, red geranium, and curry all right in there. I want a yellow. And I know the yellows stay true. I've been using the sunflowers. So we're going to use that. All right. So my plate's leather hard. You can tell I can hold it pretty firmly. Should I do a green in there? You know, what makes fall colors look so great is the green. Like, the oranges are nice, but having a green something every once in a while is nice. So this is green leaf. We'll just put that over here. And we'll do a couple greens. Maybe we'll make the leaf. I don't know. We're going to have to see. All right, I got a little bucket of brushes. A bunch of different craft brushes. This is Crafter's Choice Royal Langnickel number 1. This is a really nice one because it's little and it gets into the small areas. This is also a number 1 Crafter's Choice. I've got two of the same brush. I am so lucky. I'm going to use those. And that should do it. I mean, you could pick yourself up. This came from a hobby store in a pack of like 10 really cheap brushes for like $5. Maybe it was even less. I don't know. But those will work too. All right. Now I'm just going to take some water and have it on hand. I could probably use my working water. I'm just going to get my brush wet. And then we're going to start. And I have to decide what I'm going to start with. Well, let's just go ahead and start with the tangerine peel. So that's the orange. And I like to keep my reference with me so that I can see what I'm doing, right? So I'm just going to have that right there. Actually, you know what? I want to start with the red. The red's going to be the boldest color. Sorry, this is how it is in life, right? We make changes as we go. So we're going to start with the red. And I have pear trees and apple trees in here. I'm not going to make my pear tree red. You can though, in your world. So I'm just going to go ahead and I'm going to fill in the entire tree with this red. Because it's translucent, I know it's not going to hide my black lines and my little black apples. If it does anything, it'll make the apples look a deep, deep dark red. So I did one there, and then do one over here. You could wait and do this at the bisque stage if you want to. You do not have to do this now, but if you do it now, all you have to do at the bisque stage is glaze it, and then you're done, and you're ready to put it in the kiln. So it's all about time and what works best for you in your workflow. You know, if you don't have time to add the color now, you don't have to add the color now. You can wait. If now's the only time you have, then go for it. Put your color in there. And if you don't want to add color, you don't have to. You could just make these plates and then put a glaze on them that's translucent and go with that. We'll do this one's red too. He doesn't know it, but it's red. Put that in there. So that's going to look really cute. I have got the sienna. Did I want to do some sienna? I think so. So let me grab sienna out of here. There it is. So sienna is a nice warm brown. And I have some little leaves that are just plain. So I'm going to use that for those. Amoco velvet underglaze are great for watercolor if you dry them out first. Yes. So you can put them in a palette like I have and let them dry out. And a lot of my Mishima is watercolor pottery, and that's what I use for it. And I did start with Amoco to begin with. I switched because of I was a student and on a budget, so I switched to Speedball and used Speedball for a long time. And now I use all kinds. I use Speedball, I use Amoco, I use Mako, I use Colors for Earth. I will use anybody's underglaze these days. Why should we limit ourselves, right? So I'm just going to make these guys. This is going to be the sweetest little plate. I'm super excited. So I did those guys. I've got mushrooms in there. What color should make the mushrooms? We could go darker brown with the mushrooms. I have burnt umber, which does a really nice, cool, warm, coolish warm. Let me see. No, that's, I think, warm brown. It's pretty intense, though, so we're going to thin it down a lot. Yeah, if you let them dry out, you can use them just like a watercolor and then just add water to it. And it's really nice because you're not wasting anything. If I was making this a springtime themed thing, I might make my mushrooms bright red, right? To go with the bright greens. But because we're doing an autumn palette here, I'm going to go with the browns for my mushrooms. So we could be here for a while doing this. You can see how this could be really fun if you have people in your lives that like to do this, like coloring and stuff. Maybe they don't want to make the plate. Maybe you make the plate for them. I was thinking more like little ones, you know. If you have children or grandchildren or nieces or nephews or you teach, this is a great thing for the kids to do. They can add the color part to it. All right, so let's go with the green. And I'm gonna do this one with the green. And this is that leaf green. Might be the only one. Oh, there's one down here that I have on this plate. So a bigger piece, you're gonna have, you know, more decal area that you can add color to. A little bit over here. Up there too. Put a little bit up there. So can you do, yes, underglaze, let it dry, and then put decals over it. You don't let it dry all the way though. And I did do a tutorial on using underglaze with Sanbao underglaze decals. And that's a past broadcast. I think Kevin can go ahead and grab that for everybody watching. So if you want to watch, I don't know, I think that might have been a primetime broadcast. So you can watch that. But I showed how to use the underglaze first. So you can put underglaze under your underglaze decals. So now I'm doing yellow on the pears. Then, let's see, did red, Florida orange. I'm gonna do this, I'm thinking about a leaf I saw today. It had yellow, it had orange, and it had red. It was everything. It was amazing. I didn't take a photo of it because looking at it, I knew a photo would not do it justice, so I didn't even bother. I looked at it and I just said, you know, I'm just going to keep it in my mind and not take a picture because the photo would never be like the real thing and it would actually lessen the leaf. Does that make sense? I mean, sometimes you don't want pictures of everything. Oh, hey, Joni's here. She just got out of work. We're still going to put orange, though, so I'll need to do another Florida orange. I need a little more of that. This one's going to be orange. I think this would be really fun. Oh, maybe we'll put a purple in here. You know, with different palettes of color, you could do one that's just all blues. That might be it for the orange. What else we got? We did sienna. Do you want to do more green? I got that darker green, that laurel. Let's use that. Your sister won't touch doing pottery because she doesn't like getting her hands dirty, but she'll come and glaze. I love that. I love that. One of my daughters is the exact same way. She won't touch clay, but she would paint stuff on. But she's not going to touch the clay. No. Let me shake this a little more. So you set your palette up. Ideally, you'd have more than one to do, right? You wouldn't just be sitting here working with one piece. You would have 4 or 5 or 10 or whatever you have. I mean, maybe you have friends come over and help you, right? And everybody glazes one a different way or colors one a different way. So I'm going to do this big tree here. I'm going to do the inside. And look what I did. I put a little too much on, okay? Take my sponge and just tap it out. You could also use a paper towel. And if there's any left that I don't want when it's leather hard, I can carefully go in and just scrape it off. Just if you do the tiniest scraping, it's not going to scrape away the clay. So that one's going to be a dark green. Ooh, we've got many of them. So we could be here for a while. And I'm sure you all don't want to watch me paint all night. Do you? Maybe. So if you use the orchard rolling pin and then use a wash on greenware, could I glaze with colors of earth or should I glaze between? You could, on greenware, add underglaze colors to a piece made with the orchard rolling pin. Yeah, absolutely. You can add your colors then if you want to. One thing I like about adding colors before the bisque is if you get a color on there you don't want, it can be easier to remove sometimes because bisque ware is very thirsty and it sucks the color right up and it can be easier to pull it off. So now I think I'm going to mix some colors. We've got the red. I'm going to mix that with a bit of the orange appeal, the Florida orange. The orange appeal is a Mako stroke and coat. Got to keep them all straight. It can be hard sometimes. So I'm going to make this, ooh, which one? Eeny, meeny, miny, this one. This is a blended red-orange. I'll put that on. Yeah, and we use cornstarch on this, and you notice how it's not causing me any trouble at all. Like we're not having any problems with the cornstarch resisting and preventing the color from soaking in. It just breaks down and goes away. Oh, I know what I'm gonna make purple. I got that other tree. So let's see what we got for our purple. The violet. Bright violet. We're gonna make the pear trees a bright violet. And I see how I've got, look at this, now I got color on them. I see how I have a apple tree that I missed. So I can go back in and get it with the red. Okay, and now we'll do the violet for that pear. This one here. Because there's a lot of violet in the fall. You wouldn't think so. No, there's a ton of wildflowers that are this color blooming right now. They bloom right up until snow comes. And they're just these little tiny sweet flowers. They're actually a weed, but I don't care. They have flowers on them. So if a weed has flowers, it's a flower. But they're all over the place right now. And so I was looking at color in the fall and how many different colors we have. You know, we still have some green. We have our evergreens. We have the oranges, the reds, the yellows. You've got some browns. You've got purple. So many colors happening right now. It's my favorite time of the year. But the leaves are going quick, I'll tell you. They're falling all over. All right, what is this one? What? They're wild aster. I think I knew that. The wild aster. I love them. Anne knows. Anne's my go-to. When I need any info on gardening, I ask Anne. She helped me a few weeks ago. We talked about my hydrangeas and planting things. So I think a little yellow, but maybe it orange yellow. So I just warming it up with a little bit of orange in that yellow. I mean, you make it up as you go. Where else? Any others? There's one over there. And there's one over here. Let's get that one. So it's basically done. I've got a little flower that I can put a color in. And I think that's gonna do it. Do this in sienna right there. Green. We did the leaf green on this one. The brighter of the two greens. And then there's some other colors, just like, you know, if you got some little things to fill in. All right, so the last thing I have is this little tiny tulip down there. It's a little teeny tiny tulip. So I gotta do something. I'm going to do, would it be weird to do it sapphire blue? I know tulips aren't blue, ever. We could do a yellow tulip. Oh, but there's yellow right there. We'll go red. Red tulips. Very traditional. Do I have another? Nope, that was the only one. All right, so look at this right here. How cute. I'll hold it up so we'll have Kevin. There's another one. Thank you. I would have seen it right before I put it in the bisque, right? And then I would have had to go back in and add the color. So we got another tulip. And then you have the centers of these flowers here, which would they be left out if we didn't do a little dot of yellow on them? Don't get away. Stay put. Yes, they would. So we're going to just put a little dot of yellow. Okay. That's it. It's done. It just has to dry. I might come back in and do some work, like this leaf here might want a little shading, so I might come in. The great thing about doing it now is if I bisque fire it and I realize that, I want to pull it up so you can see it standing up. I'm going to zoom out a bit so everybody can see. So if you do this now and you bisque fire it and you realize you didn't go intense enough with your colors, you can add more color. Instead of waiting till after you glaze fired it and you see, oh, my color is not gonna work, right? So you don't have surprises. The leaf, the great thing about this is I added some color to it now, but I can go ahead and wait until it's bisque fired and then add more color to it and make it more of an ombre going on. Now the edge, if you want to, you can edge it with a color. So you could pick one of these colors for earth underglaze colors and do the edge with it, or you just leave it alone and don't do anything to the edge. So there we have it. We did the color on there. So you managed to track down colors for earth in the UK at a warm glass studio. Okay, so they're sold as glass paints and are a dry mix. Are they the same? I am not sure. So we'll get Paula to answer that. So now, this right here, I am still going to weigh it down more because it's not dry all the way. It's still on its way to drying. But what I really want to show you is, you know, we got these two here. And you can see the difference. Go to the overhead. I think that'll work really well. And actually, I have one, the one we just made. I can grab that and show. So you can see color, no color. I mean, it's your choice. They take longer, of course, to add the color like we did. But the payoff, I think, is going to be well worth it. So it's entirely up to you. Now, the dry mix is the enamels. They do have the concentrates just like what I'm using, but it's a little different. Okay. So I will still, once this is dry, which it pretty much is, I will put my weight bag back on it and let it finish drying all the way. Until it's bone dry, I will leave this weight bag on. And then I don't get any warping on my plates because it was kept flat the whole time. And that's how I prevent warping on my slab built plates. So there we have it. So this will be dry, oh my gosh, in like 2 days. These will dry crazy fast. I'll be able to bisque fire this by Wednesday? No, we're on Wednesday. By Saturday, I'll be able to bisque fire this. And then I can glaze it in my next glaze fire, which will probably be not this Sunday, but next Sunday is my plan to have a kiln opening. All right. So Colors for Earth, do we have a discount code? I don't know if we have one right now. As Paula's on, we can ask her, but we'll have to ask. So Sanbao underglazes, underglaze decals. We do have a discount. It's ClayShare 15. You save 15% off underglaze decals. You get the new orchard. I didn't have time to do the buoys, but if we look at the buoy design and how fun and nautical this could be, doing the same thing, except I would do a different shape plate, but filling in each and every one of these buoys, it would be awesome. I'm gonna Instagram folks are just gonna get a buoy screen. I just held it up. I know, kiln opening. That means I gotta get going on the glaze. All right, so in prime time next, we are gonna make holiday mugs, hand-built and a wheel-thrown version. I am going to give away 9 sheets of underglaze decals. There are Christmas ones, Halloween ones. My snowflake pattern is in here, along with a couple others of my designs. And there's an orchard and a buoy sheet in this. And this is for one of our premium members. You don't have to do anything. Just be a member and you will win. I'm going to grab the Let It Snow mug so I can show you guys a preview. And I will announce the winner next. Super excited. Next week, we're going to have Drew from Clayscapes Pottery join us, and he is going to do a glazing tutorial because we got glazing coming up. Put it on camera, too. So this is the Let It Snow decal. This is one of the new ones coming out, and then the Winter Trees, which is coming out from Sanbao in a few weeks, probably more like a week now. We're going to make these. This is a thrown one. So we're going to make these next. We'll do a hand-built version and a wheel-thrown version. Just gonna have to wait and see and give away decals. Paula's got a code. Awesome. ClayShare 10 for 10% off right now. Okay, so you want to get yourself some Colors for Earth? Not the display. I got the display at Joann's, and look, I knocked them all over. But you can get your Colors for Earth 10% off with Paula McCoy if you use ClayShare 10, all capitals for that ClayShare, 10. And you get 10% off right now Like Jeff did a discount last week on his ovals, which is good for the whole month for ClayShare members. So I'll share that info next. All right, everybody. That's it. That's all I got tonight. I will see you all next week with Drew. And primetime next, we're going to make mugs. I hope you're ready. It's going to be lots of fun. And it's going to get you in the spirit for winter. Bye, everyone.